With so many options, how do you pick which games to play? That's our main topic tonight on episode 251 of the Tabletop Bellhop Gaming Podcast.
In addition to discussing our board game selection process, we will be reminding everyone about our two anniversary giveaways, sharing the games we've been playing lately and reviewing Warhammer, Fantasy Roleplay, Elector Counts, and The Stuff of Legend.
Before that, some introductions. I'm Sean, your host, and here with me we have our editor and webmaster, Deanna.
Hey there to all my fellow cardboard connoisseurs.
And the tabletop bellhop himself, Mo T.
I am Mo Tuzano, the tabletop bellhop, your cardboard concierge, working with you to make your game nights better.
We record this podcast live Wednesday nights at 8 p.m. Eastern at twitch.tv/tabletopbellhop, and it would be awesome if you joined us in the lobby, our chat room. This episode was sponsored by Grand Gamers Guild and made possible in part due to the support of our Patreon patrons.
You can find detailed show notes for this episode at tabletopbellhop.com/episode251. That's 251. Links there may be affiliate links, which cost you nothing but support us.
Now, some games mentioned tonight, including our featured reviews, were provided by publishers.
The Tabletop Bellhop team is here to answer your gaming and game night questions.
So tonight's question comes from a family member of mine, my Uncle Claude. We just got back from spending a week on his farm up in Northumberland County. While there, we talked quite a bit about what we do for a living and how it works and what we talk about and what our show's about and all of that. He's kind of fascinated by the fact that we talk about board games for a living. Now, one question he asked, I actually thought was an interesting one and worth bringing up on the show. And that was something that came up after I explained how many new games come out every year, the sheer volume of releases that happen each year in the board game industry.
So what Uncle Claude asked us was, with so many games coming out each year, how do you choose which ones to play?
And while it's a real question for us, it's an even more important problem for gamers out there with tight budgets. Where do you even think, start to think about buying new games?
Now, a lot of people not familiar with the modern board game industry have no clue how big the industry is. We're not talking about 100 new games a year. We're talking many thousands of new games coming out each year and coming out in bundles generally around different game conventions. With the amount of content being produced, it can be really hard to know what's worth checking out. You don't want to miss the great games, right? Plus, as we said many times on this show, not every game is for everyone, and that's awesome. But figuring out which one is going to be the right one for your group can be hard. So I'm hoping what we can do for you tonight is give you some ideas on what you can do to avoid making the wrong choice.
And heck, we still screw up and we pick the wrong games now and then. And we really try to vet them and we still pick some that are just not for us.
At least, though, when we pick wrong, you all get the benefit of our knowledge and mistakes.
That's true. And I will admit, when we pick wrong, we still play the game and let you know about it. Now, I thought the most interesting way to do this, and I kind of went through various formats for tonight's show before landing on what we are going to do tonight, was to start off talking about what we look for. Originally, I was just going to make this big list of things to look for, and I think it'd be more interesting for folk to hear what our personal preferences are and what we look for. And I think especially because it's not the same for all three of us. What I look for in a game is different than what Deanna does and is different from what Sean does. Now, I'm going to start off, and then we're just kind of mix in between us. We're not going to go Mo's list, Sean's list, D's list. We're just going to kind of all talk about it at once. Now, when picking games for me, there are quite a few factors I look at. There's definitely no one right answer, the one thing that if you do this, I will be looking at your game. That doesn't exist for me. But one of the big ones that has a larger impact than you would think, and like if someone asked me off the top of my head, I wouldn't have thought about it, but if I sit down and think about it, and it's kind of surprising to me there, and maybe it's because of being a reviewer and having relationships with publishers, is who is publishing the game and who is the designer, and kind of both at once, really. Because there are a number of publishers and designers that tend to make games all in the same kind of genre, the same feel. They tend to make games I like. And I'm always hyped when they announce a new game. Now, out of all there's a large group of them. I'm just going to call it one publisher in particular, CGE. CGE is a publisher where if they release a game under the CGE, not one of the Heidelberg games they're bringing over, Heidelberg, but the CGE game, if I hear CGE is putting in a new game, I want to know about this game. I want to know what it is, who's putting it out, who's the designer, what's it look like, how heavy is it? They're type of games intrigue me and interest me, and I've yet to play a CGE game I haven't enjoyed in some way. This even goes down to their lighter games. They also make some party games, but party games I like, which is kind of fascinating to me. So if I hear about a new CGE game, I'm going to start doing some research. I'm going to look it up at Board Game Geek. When we go to Origins or Gamma Expo, I'm going to go to the CGE booth and see if I can try the game. Now, what an established publisher gives me is a level of trust, right? I know the types of games they publish. I know what the component quality is going to be like. And here CGE is a perfect example because they like to reuse components over games. I know I'm going to get little round plastic discs to track things instead of cubes, for example. I know they can edit a rule book, and I know they actually develop their games. They're not rushed out. By going with a publisher or designer, I know they're a known quantity. Now, if you also have a list of publishers you trust, what you can do to help find out about their games is, well, check their websites, but no one remembers to go back, right? The big one, join their newsletters. This is important for them. They're going to appreciate you being on their newsletter. Join Facebook groups, Discord servers, if they've got their own subreddit. There are many ways you can actually now follow along with a publisher. Follow them on social media.
Now, like Mo, publishing is also a big deal for me. Frankly, an unknown publisher has an uphill battle here, as a lot of up-and-coming publishers put out garbage or rush work before it's ready. More established publishers I enjoy are putting out solid, well-developed, and finished games that I can rely on.
Yeah, I hate to say it because there are some indie publishers out there doing great things, but it is a red flag that makes me pause and really stop to consider if I want to check out a game or not when it isn't from a publisher that I already know, like, and trust. Like, we have gotten burned in the past too many times. So now it's just that stop, and I really have to vet them further and look at it much care. It's not that we don't do indie games. You'll see that we have some coming up in our pile of obligation. It's just that we really stop and do extra care and consideration when picking them because they don't have that. Oh, it's, I already know that I trust them to an extent. A publisher I trust, like, say, Grand Gamers Guild, even if I can find a game that's not my style, I know the component quality is going to be good. The rule book's going to be well written. It's like it's already pre-vetted to an extent.
Now, kind of going along with that, there are also game lines, certain styles of games, a very popular game line out there that many people trust and will buy everything for is the Catan line. There was a point in time where we played Catan every Saturday, and then the following Tuesday, we went to the friendly local game store, Hugin & Munin, and bought whatever next expansion so we could add that the next Saturday. We did that for an entire summer and had a fantastic time. Now, for something a little more contemporary and modern, for me, the Valeria card games from Daily Magic Games have this. I have yet to find a Daily Magic Valeria game I did not enjoy. And they, again, range all over from trick-taking card games to brain-burning Euros. Designers are similar, right? I know what if you know that if I hear Stefan Feld, I want to look into it, right? Or I'm going to be curious about anything Vital Lacerda is putting out, especially if I hear it's Vital Lacerda and Ian O'Toole working together on a game again. Immediately, I'm like, come on, match made in heaven. What are they going to give me next? What's the next big thing from them? I'm already, again, it's the same thing we mentioned with the publishers, right? I know what to expect from these line of games. I'll have a similar field. Valeria games use similar resources. I always know the blue triangle is mana and will be able to be used with another resource as the same resource. It's the wild card. The circle is going to be crowns. The red's going to be some type of strength. There'll be dice involved. There'll be battling monsters, right? There's a certain feel of the games.
Yeah, if Stefan Feld's name's on the box, just put it on the table now, please. Actually, no, I'm horrible for not paying enough attention to designers' names, which we talked about a few weeks ago. But there is a short list that gets my attention immediately. But there's also hearing things like from the creator of X game that I already like, that can catch my attention as well.
And I got to say, that's a good call, actually, to go back to our last episode. We talked kind of about our board game background and where we came from. And a big part of me being a hobby gamer is the first time my parents said, here's $20, you're buying something, but it can't be a heavy metal cassette tape. And I went into Leisure World at Devonshire Mall and I picked up a game called Talisman. Note, it might have been $40 a game. I don't know how much Talisman cost. Maybe it was 30. Whatever Talisman cost back in like 80, whatever. And I brought home Talisman and I loved it so much, my game collection quickly grew with games like Dungeon Quest and Curse of the Mummy's Tomb and Chainsaw Warrior. And what those games have in common is they all said from the publisher of Talisman, from the makers of Talisman. And they actually had the Talisman on the bookshelf spine. So it was so easy. You go to Leisure World and just look for the Talisman symbol. And I'm like, that's a good game. And again, I was okay. Chainsaw Warrior is a little disappointed because it was a solo only game and I wasn't into that at the time, but the rest of those games are fantastic.
Yeah, you're talking about what's on the box, and that's making me think about mismatched expectations. You know, like when you think you're getting a family weight game and it ends up being strategically heavy or even a little dark. We talked about this in a couple of previous episodes. Episode 207 looks like kids' games, but they're not. And more recently in episode 248, clickbait board games, where we talked about how to ensure you get the game you think you're getting. I feel like we've already deep dived this point already, so I'm just going to drop a link in the show notes and leave it at that.
Next for me is hype. Honestly, I fall for the hype sometimes. If I start hearing this hype, but it has to be hype about something doing something new. Like, oh, you have to check this out. And the main thing I think of this is I think of when I'm at a con, right? So we are at Origins and we're walking around Origins. The doors have just opened. It's not even open to the public yet. The only people in there are Gamma retailers and media folk, and everyone's running over to the Arcane Wonders booth. And I'm like, what's going on? I need to know what's happening. So that's an example of that. And I think the game was Iota, I think was the name of the game that was selling out, which we didn't get to check out because they sold out before. I think it was 10 minutes after the doors opened, they were out of copies. Another example is we were at Origins again, and a friend of ours came over and was like, oh my God, you got to check out this game, Go Cuckoo. This is the best game I've ever played. It is awesome. You have to play Go Cuckoo. So we went and tried Go Cuckoo, and I'm like, yes, please, T, let us take home Go Cuckoo. You know, like, hype for me is a thing, and hype will get me to look at something I would have otherwise overlooked. And I got to say, Go Cuckoo is definitely something I would have overlooked.
I think the game this year at Origins that everyone was lining up to get was Edo.
Iota.
Yeah, unlike Mo, I have to admit, I rarely care about hype. And in fact, a clear and obvious campaign of hype, a clear and obvious campaign of hype can turn me off. I don't like the manufactured hype that goes around these times. And that's what a lot of it is these days. Yeah. It bubbles up around release dates and then magically vanishes. And frankly, you never hear about some of these games ever again after that release window has gone and and no one's getting paid or suggested or sent copies to talk about.
Yeah, I got to say, it's hard to not confuse or tell the difference between hype and advertising. Now, the hype I'm looking for is generally from gamers, right? It's podcasters, new board game geek threads, seeing friends and people who share similar tastes. Like I have Kickstarter notifications on, and if I start getting the X back this, Y back this, Z back this, C back this, D back this, I'm like, okay, wait, what's going on with this game? Why is everyone I know back this game? Social media posts I follow as well. But yeah, there's definitely a lot of advertising, especially going around with new releases and crowdfunding.
Yeah, I don't want to sound too jaded, but as someone who's worked as a content creator for like 14 years now, paid or pre-planned marketing versus genuine hype kind of stands out to me. Like, yeah. There is a thing where publishers try to coordinate marketing around the release date, so you get this burst of social media messages and reviews that all come out on one afternoon, and it's definitely a Kickstarter thing. And a lot of specifically with Kickstarter, a lot of it is paid. You need to look at the source. Is it reliable? Is it someone you already know? You have an idea of what they like, what they don't like about a game? And if it's from someone who does game reviews, is it a detailed review or is it just their first thoughts? Like we will talk about a game when we've just played it once, but we're usually pretty clear about the fact that we're just, when it's on tabletop, we're talking about, this is our first thoughts on a game. We're just testing it out. That's the kind of thing that you want to keep an eye out for.
Now, another one I watch for is awards. I know we talked about awards multiple times in the show. We haven't actually done an episode of awards. Maybe we should at some point. But I know they have problems. All awards have problems. There are issues with many of the awards out there. And not everyone loves the awards. But I got to say, there are certain awards that I trust, I guess is a way to put it, that will lead me to a game I wouldn't have looked at otherwise. Right. So the big ones for me, of course, are the Origins Awards and the Spiel des Jahres. If I was still doing RPGs, the Ennies would be up there. to get this will get me to look at a game I would have completely missed or not even considered, right? So a recent example, Smug Owls. We were sitting at the Origins ceremony because we were up for an award. So here's the reason people should believe awards, because we were up for one. We were nominated for an award. So we were at the ceremony, and this game, Smug Owls, won an award. And they had a fan base in that room that were all hoot, 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 hoot when they won. And I'm like, okay, I got to go look at what this game is tomorrow, because I've already been everywhere on the floor and didn't even notice this game. Because of that award, I went and checked it out. They showed me the game, and I'm like, this sounds fantastic for a public play event. And we brought a copy home.
Yeah, I mean, we originally picked up Catan because it was listed in Games Magazine as one of their recommended games of the year. Like, I don't think it was number one, but it was in the top 100. I actually went back and looked the other day because I was curious, and I didn't see it listed as a game of the year, but I know that's where we originally found it. But not all awards are created equal. But I think there are definitely ones you want to pay attention to, like Origins, Spiel des Jahres, as Mo said. And you probably want the Kennerspiel and not the Kinderspiel unless you're looking for kids' games. I'm going to butcher the pronunciation of this because I am not French. Last d'Or Jeu de l'année, the Golden Ace Awards, it's given out during the Cannes International Film Festival. That one seems pretty legit. Mm-hmm. And Golden Geek, etc.
Yeah. On the other hand, words that I haven't heard of are often red flags. If you're trying too hard to make your game feel special, I'm wondering about it. And then also, as we were saying, you know, there are some less impressive awards out there. After learning the process that some of these awards go through to pick their games, some awards, like the Mensa Awards, for instance, don't really mean anything to me anymore.
Yeah, I this one was amusing because I left a gap in the notes because I figured Sean would complain about Mensa, and there it is. So I didn't have to. So that one.
I did the exact same thing.
I'm like, Sean will complain about men, so we're good there. Now, another one. This is possibly the biggest in a way. Like once the game's caught my attention, the next step, the big next step before I commit to a game is getting to try before I buy, right? This has grown more and more important to me over the years. This is the big factor nowadays. Now, a lot of this happens for us at game convention. Now, that includes both full plays of games as well as game demos. There's no better way to know if a game is for you and your group other than to sit down and play it. Especially if your whole group goes to Origins, sit down and play it, and then you'll know. If you have a great time, bring that game home. Now, local game nights are also good for this if you have any local events, and as is just being part of your local gaming community. Now, many game stores run demo nights or have organized play. Plus, you can just make friends with other local gamers and play their games. I know for some of us who are part of this community, you want to own them all, right? You don't have to be the only one who buys games. You can play other people's games. But in general, the more games you play, not even just this game's for me, even if you don't like a game you play or do a demo of, you now know better what types of games you like, and you can figure out what didn't I like about that game so I can avoid it in the future. The more games you play, the more games you're going to know, and the better you'll get to know your own tastes.
I kind of wanted to ask for that part in writing about not needing to own all the games, but I realize you've actually kind of gotten better at that over the years.
Oh,
you used to be like, I need to catch them all, and now you're like, I'm going to be more discerning, and I'm happy to play them with other people, too. Well, no, you can't. There's, 5,000 games a year? You can't keep up with that.
Exactly.
Many FLGSs have a shelf of demo copies that you can pick through and try in the store, and then there's also game cafes, and going over to that one guy's house that already owns all the games. I think conventions are my favorite for this. Origins, the demo hall at Origins, yes, of course, but also smaller cons. Like, for example, Breakout in Toronto, they have a massive game library on hand. And so if you don't mind reading the rules and figuring it out yourself or looking for those handy, willing-to-teach table markers that they put out, you can test drive a ton of games over a couple of days.
Yeah. Now, don't forget about Tabletop Simulator and other virtual tabletops. Mm-hmm. Those are there, too. And this is something a lot of Kickstarters now offer as a way to try before you buy. And as well, many games are now being developed there. And once they aren't secret anymore, that content often gets released to the public, either paid or free, in order to play that game online and get the digital experience. Now, while the actual fiddliness of Tabletop Simulator has annoyed us. When you look past that, and if you are able to look past that, you can tell a lot about the game that's being played.
And I guess just to add to that, there's, of course, Board Game Arena, which we do love, though learning games on there is a little iffy, but I don't think it's any worse than Tabletop Simulator. There's also digital versions of games, and watch Humble Bundle and Steam sales. You can generally get any of those big board game digital versions cheap at some point during every year. Right now, there's a great one over at Humble Bundle, but I think that ends in 2 days, or outside Toshio Link. Now, one for me that has changed. So this used to be a big deal for me. Then COVID hit and it didn't matter at all. And our game selection purchase has actually changed because of it. But now that I'm back hosting public play events here in Windsor again, what I look for is something that's eye-catching. I love dexterity games. I love big set piece games. If you're building something up, that's fantastic. I forget the name, but that Cosmos game where you built a giant pyramid out of like ice cubes, anything like that, I like, and it's going to catch my attention, and I'm going to see if there's a game there, right? It's not just some big gimmick, because some of these are just gimmicky, but a lot are solid games. And what I want is I want that person who showed up driving by and went, oh, the Walkerville Brewery is open. I'm going to go in for a pint. They go in for a pint and they go, whoa, what's that? And they walk over and they say, what's that? And I tell them, grab the hammer and hit the tower or stack the piece or pull a thing or, you know, whatever happens to me, twist the thing or the giant avatar in the middle or the Darth Vader in the Rising games. Those I look for, but as a host of public play events. So obviously that's not going to apply to everyone out there, but it is a key factor to me being interested in a game. And I guess just to extend that a bit, not even the table present, but just this is a good pub game for new players is also something.
It's a mixed bag for me. Like, I do appreciate that a game like Boop, by being cute and having cats bouncing on a bed instead of just being a strictly abstract game, draws people in and makes it easier to sell to people to get them to play it. But I tend to like heavier games, and the games with the cute table presents all tend towards the lighter side of things. But then again, there is a certain look to heavier games that does draw me in. Like when we were walking around the floor at Origins, I spotted Terminus and I was like, ooh, what's that? So yeah, something with cute cat meeples draws in most folks, but I'm like, say, hey, that looks like a heavy game. Tell me more about that one.
Yeah, one of the things I look for, of course, is theme. Now, I think a lot of people, anyone who watches the show regularly, knows that supers and sci-fi are really going to hook me. But it's not just those. There are other themes that will catch my attention at all as well. And I admit, box art is going to influence me. But so is the design of the component. Even if that box does catch me and catch my eye on the shelf, I'm going to turn it around. Or if I'm shopping on Amazon, click to the next picture and look at the back of the box. Take a look at the components in there and see if anything either stands out as beautiful or, wait, that looks really hard to read, or, you know, something of that nature. How that game presents itself is going to make a big difference.
Yeah, and to go along with that is accessibility. Tiana has not the best eyesight. Hopefully we're getting it all fixed, but readability, clear iconography, things like that is extremely important. Now, for me, theme doesn't matter as much. Like, to me, it's not a big deal. I don't really care. I'm much more interested in the mechanics, if the game's doing something new, how engaging it is, how it makes me think. And I got to say, if you publish yet another farming zombie or trading in the Mediterranean game, your game better be doing something pretty cool otherwise, because those themes are actually a turn off instead of a turn on for me. I'll easily overskip your zombie game unless someone tells me, hey, you got to check out this particular zombie game. But yeah, the component quality is actually a big part. If having different shaped components, it doesn't affect us, but colorblind friendly pieces is important for my public play events. I may not have vision issues, but other people may. So I got to say, that is definitely something to be considered when looking at games. If I start hearing that, like, this game is super accessible, they do everything better, it's going to catch my eye.
And component quality is huge. It's just something I find that you don't really know until you get that game in your hand, which is another reason why to test it if you can, right?
Yeah.
I wanted to say that I don't care about theme, and then I started thinking, but certain themes like civ building or sci-fi or ancient history, they do draw me in and make me look twice. Yeah. And other themes like zombies and sports are going to repel my interest. So I guess theme matters. I acknowledge it can, you know, It really depends. And then, you know, it depends on how abstract the game is, how tied in the theme is. Sometimes the theme is almost immaterial to the game.
Mm-hmm. So more than anything, what is perhaps the hardest factor to determine is if it's got legs. Will it keep coming back to the table? Because I have no interest in buying the new hotness that will be fun for 5 sessions and then never get played again. So here's where you can go to that older information on Board Game Geek. Talk to your friendly little game store and ask others in the area who may have purchased a game. And perhaps most importantly, ask your favorite reviewers. Have they ever played the game again after mm-hmm. they reviewed it? That can be a huge deal. If you review a game and you like it, but you've never found a way to ever play it again or interest in playing it again afterwards, that can be a red flag.
Yeah, and that one is so hard to judge. Like, you have to go to reviewers. You have to go to Board Game Geek. You have to listen to podcasts. Like, you have to find someone else's opinion. There's no rating for replayability on the game box, right? And it is so hard to tell. There are some games that I absolutely adore, and I played it, and I put it on a 10x10 challenge. And up to game 7, I loved it. But then 8, 9, and 10, it just got repetitive. I felt I'd seen everything the game has to offer. There was nothing left to discover. I've now tried all the factions, and I've tried them all against each other, and I've seen them all in play. And I'm just like, no, this game's kind of spent. Then other games I've played over 150 times, and I'm still not sick of. And I don't know what that special magic is. I'm not going to call out the two specific games that are in my head right now. But it is definitely a thing, and it's also subjective. And some people, it's personality type dependent. Some people are perfectly happy playing the new hotness once or twice and moving on to the next thing. They're perfectly happy and enjoy that, and all the power to them. The publishers love you. The industry probably wouldn't exist without you, so please keep it up. But then there's other people who, like, don't want to try anything new. There are local gamers who have they have a game they play. And then maybe they get sick of it after years of playing that game and move on to something else. So that is something else. It is definitely a thing. And it's personality type dependent as much as game dependent.
So one of the places I like to go to for information on games is Reddit. And this is interesting because, again, people know me and I talk about Board Game Geek all the time. But mm-hmm. I love digging into Reddit for reviews about almost anything. You're getting raw and uncensored opinions there, for better or worse. But when people have a bone to pick or have biases, they generally kind of wear them on their shirts, on their sleeves. They don't hide it. So it's easy to discount those. So while Board Game Geek has real value and the statistics and information there is fantastic, the reviews for newer games can often be very questionable and muddied by opinions about a publisher or a designer or an artist or somebody's doesn't like the font they used for the title. So I like the Reddit because that information is out there. You know, the people, again, are really obvious about what they have. While Board Game Geek, you can look into those designers and artists fantastically, but unless the board game's been around for a little while, you have to sort of really be careful with the reviews and the ratings.
Yeah, the big thing on Board Game Geek, I got to say, is check how many people, right? Before you trust a rating on Board Game Geek, if it's less than 100, I'd almost say less than 500 people, you can't really put a lot of value into that. Plus, Board Game Geek is alpha gamers, it's hardcore board gamers who have taken time to make an account on a honestly hard to use, ugly looking site just so they can share their hobby versus Reddit kind of everyone uses, and you're going to get a very different user base. Like if the Board Game Geek skews towards heavier, complicated games, things with more detail, they tend to look down on simple, easy to play, quick games, right? You get a totally different demographic. Now, I will admit I've gotten more into Reddit in the last few years, but at this point, I can't think of a single game that because of a Reddit review I picked up or the other way around. I can't think of anything. I was like, oh, no, after reading that Reddit thread, I'm not touching this with a 10-foot pole. What I find Reddit good for is two things. One is rule discussions. They're usually pretty good. You can usually find people have found, you know, issues with a game. The other is asking questions like you'd ask us, So I don't really want to send people there for that. But like, it's really good for the, you know, what are games designed by women? What are some great 5-player games for after dinner? You usually find a pretty good discussion on pretty much any topic you can find. And I will admit, I use Reddit as a research source when doing our articles. Now, the Reddit ones tend to be a little shorter, but I do find them good for finding that type of info. So like, you know, I like this. What's a game like it?
Yeah, I don't think a Reddit review has ever swayed me. And I don't really go to BGG for reviews either. Just more like statistical, factual information. So I'll look on BGG and I'll check the designer and then click on their name and see 3 other games that they made that I like, that sort of thing. Though I will say, if when you're looking on BGG, you happen to notice that there's a lot of FAQ and errata on a game, that can be a flag depending on how much patience you have for that sort of thing.
Yeah, to be fair, I tend to do it now after we have the games in hand and I find a problem. I go to the rules forum. So every game has a multiple forums and one is rules. And if there's multiple pages, that means there's more than 50 posts on rules. There's probably an issue with the rule book, but I tend to find that out after the fact. Maybe that's another criteria I should be adding to my list before we say yes to a game is go check how many rule questions there were.
Unfortunately, one of the problems we do run into is, again, that Board Game Geek does trend become more useful the older a game is. Lot of times, while we're not the new hotness, we are still generally getting games earlier in their life cycle, which makes the Board Game Geek thread counts, reviews, and such a little less valuable in our line.
So that's all I had to talk about. Do you, either of you, have anything more to add on what we look for when picking a new game? All right. So here are some suggestions that not necessarily things we look for, but other things you can do to decide if a game will be right for you. And obviously, step one is listen to us, right? Listen to the Tabletop Bellhop because we know a lot about games. Now, listen to a board game podcast, right? Or consume board game media, whether that's YouTube or whatever, even TikTok, short videos can suggest games. We are one of many board game content creators, and honestly, all of us are excited to share our love of the hobby. And a big part about that is talking about the games we've been playing and sharing our thoughts on them.
Another thing that I've been thinking about is when you're picking out a new game to get for your group, you want to try and take into account the likes and dislikes of the people you normally play with. Yeah. Maybe last time you picked up a heavy game because you knew your wife would really love it, but this time you're going to get something a little lighter that will appeal to the kids. Or you're going to get a sci-fi themed game because you know that'll lure Sean into sitting down. remember, the best game is the one you actually get to the table.
Yeah, and as much as I was talking about Reddit, Board Game Geek really is your friend. Checking things like the hotness, con preview geek lists, the ratings, the forums, news, press releases. Well, you do have to be mindful of the hype. They have to have some hype or you're never going to hear about it. And if you don't hear about it, you're not going to get it to the table.
In addition to possibly hosting public play events and demo nights, a good FLGS will have knowledgeable staff that can recommend games and who know about the new hotness as well as old favorites. So ask questions, talk to them.
Yeah, there's no reason not to walk into your friendly local game store and go, what's hot? What came out at Gen Con? What are you guys bringing in? What's the hot Kickstarter?
I like X. What should I get next? You know, that sort of thing.
And if the game store is local, just tell them to hire Mo Tuzano to help. next would be board games news sites. While we talk games and review them, we are not a news source. Our Discord, we have a little kind of check it out channel where we sometimes share some board gaming news, but that's not what we do. We are not news. But there are some good ones out there. I personally recommend Board Game Wire. And I've got to say, here is a place where I do use Reddit. Our board games is one part that I do frequent, that you get a lot of release news and what people are hyped about.
All right, well, that covers our ideas for picking the right game for your game group. I haven't seen too much coming in from the lobby, but there has been some out there. You know, we've got Roger saying, if a game gets 10 plays, that's, you know, it paid for itself for him.
See, for me, that's 5. I have a lower bar, but we a lot of games cycle through here. If I can play a game 5 times, like, especially if I buy it, right? Like, I'm not talking about obligations. Like, if I buy a game, if I get 5 plays out of it, I'm pretty happy. More than that is like icing on the cake. And if it gets up to 100, I should be buying extra copies and giving to friends because, geez, this game's good.
Roger mentions learning a game is an investment. It should pay off well. And that's very true. The harder a game is to learn, the more plays you should get out of it because you've put that time into learning the game.
That one's actually going to come up on one of our reviews later tonight, actually.
Yes, it is. Now, someone was Ryan was asking how much being award nominated impacts sales. And I did a little bit of reading. The spiel in specifically, the big one. You can 10x your sales through nomination. So those four or five nominees are gonna can get up to 10x on their sales, and the winner of a Spiel du Jahr is about 100x or up to 100x on their sales. Wow. So if you're gonna sell 1,000 games, you could sell 100,000 by becoming a Spiel du Jahr winner.
But from what I understand, that's in Germany. I don't think that matches up with North American sales.
Well, that's worldwide.
Yeah, world. But a lot of those sales are gonna be in Germany. So you got to publish in German as well. It would win the Spiel, I think, to get some of that.
I think, and I mean, one of the big problems is a lot of people are questioning whether or not the Spiel is as useful as it once was. While there are a number of games like the Karks and things that have won and have the lasting power, they're classics in going back to one of our board games. There have been a number of Spiel du Jahr winners since, late 2000s, past 2010, which have been flash in the pan winners that no one plays and talks about anymore. So the award has had some ups and downs in its lifetime.
Yeah, well, they got to pick something every year. Maybe there's just no great games that
they passed on Puerto Rico 1 year in the order of a dexterity game.
Right, yeah, we're done.
Well, that's before they had other hobbies. I will call out Pat Pax, one of our long-term fans, Patreon patron. Thanks, Pax. Specifically noted, we make a habit of buying any Spiel winner that looks remotely like their thing. And that's kind of where I am with that one. Like Spiel Origins, Spiel, I'm going to play it. I want to play it. There was like a Flip Pirates or something. Flip Ships, I think, was a big one this year. I want to try that game. I'm not going to rush out and buy it, but I want to try Flip Ships just to find out why does this deserve it? Because another game that did that years ago was Imhotep. And I got to say, Imhotep didn't look like much. The Cosmos, a bunch of blocks. It looks like a dexterity game. And then we played it and it's fantastic. So now I want to call it something Beyond Dead 13 calls out. Where'd it go? Sorry. About what we were talking about earlier with a bunch of videos dropping in a 3-day period. Turns them off on a game. And I just want to share the content creator side of things. As a content creator, I hate being told you must release this content on this day, at this time. And I have turned down games because that's what's expected. For one, people like Beyond Dead and people who see it are going to see the rush and assume it's hype and are going to assume it's paid hype. We do not ever accept money for reviews. We do not do paid reviews. But if I drop my content at the same time as all the other content creators who do, it looks like we do. I start to feel like a shill and I don't like that. I kind of understand why companies do it, but I want to talk about games I'm excited about when I'm excited about them. I don't want to hold off or create content and schedule it for a certain time to come out. That just bothers me. And I admit I make the assumption if I see a whole bunch of content out on one day, I'm like, I'd start quieting. I'm like, okay, is this an advertising campaign or are these legit reviews?
And so just to go back to my thing. So in 2002, Villa Paletti was the Spiel du Jahr winner over Puerto Rico and Transamerica. Villa Paletti is rated a 6.2, and I've never heard of it other than just today reading about it.
Copy downstairs.
Come over. Mo will gladly play it with you. I will not.
It's been replaced, and I think the rating was up in the eights, and it slowly dropped as people came out with different versions. It's been re-implemented a couple times.
The re-implemented Palazzo Paletti is only a 6.7. So
yeah.
Well, taking a peek around to remember which awards I wanted to list, I noticed that Carnegie won tons of stuff, and now I really want to check it out. And it's Ian O'Toole art.
Well, yeah.
Yeah.
that one did look good.
That's on my list now.
Yep. Nope. Fair.
Think we're good?
I think we are there. No one's using our hashtag. All right. So,
well, I hope we've helped you to be able to make better board game picks. No matter how much you do something, you will find a dud. But do your research ahead of time, trying games, checking different sources, bouncing it off different reviewers, going on Board Game Geek. Doing the work ahead of time can really cut down on the frequency of buyer's remorse.
Do you have any tips or secrets for making sure you only end up picking up games that you and your group will actually enjoy? We want to hear them. Comment wherever you found this episode. Email Deanna at tabletopbellhop.com. Hit us up on social media or join in the episode discussion over on our Discord.
And now a shout out for our sponsor, Grand Gamers Guild.
The Tiernanog Kickstarter is live and doing very well. It's exploded past its initial goal and is climbing higher every day. Last time I checked, it was at over 800 backers and over $42,000. So congratulations, Mark and Grand Gamers Guild.
As you guys all know, Tiernanog is one of my favorite games that we've played over the past year. It's a mathy, puzzly game with a neat Celtic theme, beautiful art, and solid components.
The current Kickstarter not only features a new printing of the deluxe edition of the game, but has some extras as well, including a new expansion and a new Tiernanog card-based escape room game. The deluxe edition itself features a custom start player market, wood number and color change tokens, and two expansions. The Blessings and Burdens expansion features six new modules.
Now, what shocked me when I was taking a look at this, just to grab a link, actually, to throw in the show notes, is that they're offering the all-in pledge for $59, which seems really good to me. That's about $80 Canadian. So head over to Kickstarter now and go check it out.
I'm actually super curious about those card-based escape room games, like the holiday hijinks style games. But for Tiernanog and with the last Kickstarter, they did it with Endangered too. I'm super intrigued by those. But what I'm supposed to be saying here is that you all need to head over to tabletopbellhop.com and enter our Tiernanog giveaway. One lucky winner is going to get an all-in pledge when they back the Kickstarter for $1. Having the winner back the project for $1 makes things much easier as far as logistics and shipping, etc.
In case you missed it, we've got two giveaways running right now to celebrate our sixth podcasting anniversary.
Now, the first Deanna just mentioned a moment ago when talking about our sponsor, and that's the chance to win an all-in pledge for Grand Gamer Guild's current Tiernanog reprint and expansion content Kickstarter.
And the second is a chance for one fan to win their pick of one game from a list of six of the best new-to-us games that we discovered over the past year.
You can find entry pages to both these giveaways over at tabletopbellhop.com with links to each in the show notes for this episode. Now it's time for the Bellhop's Tabletop, where we talk about the games that we've been playing lately.
So we spent the last week up at my uncle's farm in Campbellford, Ontario, and most of that vacation involved hanging out with family, exploring multiple small towns in the area, checking out some craft breweries, hitting up a local swimming hole, and spending time with the family. And of course, some of that time spent with family was spent playing games.
I had a laugh when we were packing to go on this trip. Mo ended up bringing two bags of games, like a dozen games for our 7-day trip. But that's after I talked him down. He wanted to bring way more. I'm like, are you leaving all your clothes at home? Like, there's only so much trunk space. What are you doing? If you're curious as to what made the packing list, we brought My City, The Deadlies, Xylitar, Skull King, King's Coalition, The Crooked Crown, Heroes of Thargos, Hamburg, New York, Vienna, Revived, Telestrations, and Caution Signs.
I believe right. The real showing you packing the van was indicating 24 games was the original count before you convinced him to pare it down. Yeah,
it might have been that much. I don't know. Part of it was like, we're going to have time. We'll be able to play all those big, heavy games we never have time for. So up first was one of those gameplays. We played Hamburg. We introduced the game to Gwen because we've been talking about Hamburg on the show quite a bit, but she had been in Nova Scotia the whole time. So it was her first chance for her to play. She really enjoyed it. For someone who's so AP prone, she wasn't bad in this game and was very quick to pick up the iconography. Now I'm finally at the point now where I would say 80% of the time, if I get a card, I know what it does. Either I've looked it up before, it's similar enough, but I still check every single time because we've been burned. And I got to say, it took four plays of this game to even be like 80% comfortable with the iconography.
Yeah. It's it's dense. After messing it up once, I am double checking each card for sure. It gives me time to think about what I'm going to do. I am still loving this game. I just love it. I'd play it right now. Let's pause the podcast. Let's go play Hamburg.
Go play it. Now, for people who don't remember, this is the follow-up to Bruges. So if you loved Bruges, this is the follow-up to that. And everyone, I think, has heard the hype on Bruges. Is this better? They're different. There is something different. So what I find interesting, though, is the big complaint about this game is the iconography. There is a, I don't know how many page book addendum. There are hundreds of cards, and you basically have to look up each one. And since this came out, Queen has done a new Kickstarter for the series, City series, for one, to get some of them back into print. But the big thing is they have game trays inserts now, which if I'm going to flame about these games, every game in the City series could use some form of organization. Most games don't even come with baggies, not all. And they're a bit of a mess. And honestly, I would love game trays inserts. But everyone else seems to be talking about this Kickstarter as the City series with inserts. What no one seems to be talking about, which is why I wanted to bring it up tonight, is you can also get English cards for all the games. And what that is instead of being language independent icons, I think there's still the iconography, but there's text on the cards. And I got to say, I want them for Hamburg. I don't necessarily need them for the other ones, but Hamburg in particular, I would like the deck of English cards. I just think it would speed up the game so much.
Yeah, I was super intrigued when I first found out about these, but then I'm not sure. I'd have to see the cards in person, like the font size, particularly with my vision issues. The book might be better. Some of those text blurbs are super long, and I'm wondering, you know, how they're going to fit them on the card, what the layout's going to be like, right? Like, I would really have to see it. I don't know. I still think the better option is copies of the books for every player. You just need 5 copies of that index with all the cards listed in it, and you're set.
And the more you folks talk about this game, the less interested I become in playing it.
Still think, I don't know, it's one of the, it's the meme, but it's worth it. It's so good. So if you liked Marrakesh at all, I think you would like this more than Marrakesh. Anyway, what we still have to do is play the optional modules. And honestly, I'm frustrated that every time we play, we're teaching someone, because one of the modules is supposed to make the game so much better. And it goes with the hype for Bruges. The big hype for Bruges now is you got to play with the expansion, and the expansion's impossible to get. Well, that's in here, right? And it's specifically, I don't know if it was called the Boats and Bruges, but in this, it's the Boats expansion that has something happens when you roll 3s and 4s on the dice that give you more options. They kind of, so you don't end up with a bad hand or you're less limited. And I've got to say, I love Hamburg now. So anything that makes it better just sounds awesome. Now, there are 2 other modules I'm not sure on. One adds asymmetry, and note, I'm not sure on it, because I don't know if the game needs it, because there's already enough asymmetry with which cards you draft and what you take. Mm-hmm. But there's one that actually you start with different starting resources, and everyone has a power. And then there's another one where there's like a market where different actions become valued at different points in the game that sounds interesting. The big one, though, is I got to try the boats. Hopefully, we can get the boats tried soon. I know Gwen's hyped about the game, so she'll play it with us anytime we have time. So we'll hopefully get a review in the next week or so.
Yeah, I'm super looking forward to checking out the modules. We sat and looked through them at the end of our last game, and I was very intrigued. I'm really interested, actually, in the asymmetry with the starting resources. I always like that because it sort of gives you a direction to go. But I wasn't, and I'm super interested in the harbors or the boats expansion, though I didn't even realize the hype around it. I didn't realize it was a much tooted expansion from Bruges. I was just interested in it based on having looked at it, but the market one just kind of didn't get my interest, but we'll have to try it. I do think dumping all of them in at once might be a bit much.
Yeah, that's true. Then there'll be 5 plays and we can finally review it and we can talk about it.
If we have to play, it with each review, with each module separately, and then one time with all of them, that means I get 4 more plays. 4 more plays out of it before you have to put it to the side.
Sean's gonna have to play one of those if we do that, though. The all in, just
there may be rope involved.
just tie me down. All right, all the modules are in. Sean, you're all learning this game in. Let's with go. Everything. Sean sizzles.
Up next, first thoughts. New game, new to me, new to us. First time ever playing Revive, And I got to say, damn, good. Impressed. This is sweet. This one is from Aporta Games. And we got our review from the Colossal Games booth at Origins. So talking about earlier in the show, we were talking about what makes us look at a game. This is not a publisher I've tried any of their games on, but it was the look of the game that we walked up and we're like, that looks like our kind of game. Now, this is kind of a, there's a lot going on. You've got basically like a 4X style exploration, expansion, some exploitation mixed in with like, people have been calling it deck building. I have a hard time calling it deck building because the way the deck works, you're never shuffling. Like you never shuffle your deck. You just do this thing where your cards are active and then they get placed and then they go in your inactive pile and you're in an active, become active. It's deck building without a deck. I don't know. There's a tech tree, there's resource management, and honestly, quite a bit more. It's on the heavier side. Not massive, no, you know, brain burny super 5.0 game or anything, but heavy enough, but it played really smooth once we got going. Once you figured out the various different actions and how to do them, it really isn't that complicated. Now, the problem with this game, and I don't want to say it's a bad thing, but it was something that was not communicated to us well at the convention during our demo, is that this is a campaign game. In the box is a deck that says, stop, do not open this until you're ready to sit down and play your first game. And it ends up, there is a 5-scenario arc that you are supposed to play the game 5 times in a row, and each time new rules will be added to the play. Now, one nice thing about this, and this is noted right in the rule book, is this isn't a campaign where you have to have the same players or you have to use the same factions, and no, there's no legacy tearing up stickers or anything like that. This is just more like a system of onboarding where they're going to add new rules to the game so you're not overwhelmed for the first play, which is something we usually appreciate. Think the Disney Sorcerer's Arena, right? There's the alpha game, the beta game. It's kind of like that. And I got to say, with the changes from game one to game two, which we didn't play game two, but we finished game one and read what was going to happen, I don't see any reason an experienced gamer like Sean, for example, who didn't play game one, couldn't jump in at least for game two. Now, that might change by the end of game five. Maybe having all in would be too much.
Yeah, maybe that jump from base rules to all 5 expansions is just mind-boggling. I don't know. I don't mind this form of onboarding. I'm curious to see how much is added on with each campaign. What we unlocked at the end of the first session didn't feel like that much of a jump. Overall, I really enjoyed the game. I picked this one out at Origins, and I was smitten with it from the first overview, and this play did not disappoint. Like Mo was talking about, it just has a very interesting look to it. As I was talking about it, a certain style of game that might draw me over to the table, you know, very, very detailed and interesting and dual layer boards. And it's got this giant machine and you sort of peg some bits in there that give you your options for play. You were talking about it being a deck builder, and it's almost more like a hand builder. You're building a hand of cards that are available to you. And then you also have some that are in a reserve over here. They're not available. They're sleeping this round, but you know they'll be coming back out. So you very much know what you have, and there's no random element of shuffling and not knowing what cards I'm going to draw. It's just more like a hand builder. I don't know.
Yeah, and just at the start of the game, you're going to take your 6 cards. 3 are going to go up, 3 go in your reserve. But you know what those cards are. But after that, you kind of manage what's where, and there are lots of abilities to pull things out and put things in and stuff like that, too.
Yeah, it's an interesting mechanic. I dig it.
It's interesting. Now, Mo did say 4X. There isn't the attack. But no. There is no attacking. So it's a 3X game in that 4X style. Big thumbs up, though, for the onboarding. Calling it a campaign normalizes it. And really, anytime now, if you're buying a 4X or a management style video game, this is what you're going to get. You're going to get a campaign that is just, you know, 4, 5, 6 sessions of slowly introducing the different mechanics or different controls you've got so that you're ready to play the full game once you're done that little mini campaign. Big props for that.
And I have to say with the post-apocalyptic sci-fi theme, I think this one's going to be a pretty easy sell for you, Sean.
Yeah.
No rope needed.
I would almost call this a Fallout game in a way. Like there's no license here, but there's definitely a kind of a feel there. You are coming out of a cavern and you've been in there for thousands of years and exploring the world. And hey, look, there's already people up here. So there is that aspect to it. Now, what I do want to call it, Sean mentioned this about 4X board video games. There's a lot of video game elements in this one, and I thought it was interesting. Like, there were actual loot crates. I don't know if I played many other board games that have loot crates, but as you're playing, you unlock loot crates, which are little crates, and on the other side show them open, and you have to decide when to open them. So that's a really interesting aspect of Revive that I hadn't really seen in other games. And then there's just other stuff. Like, I have a feeling this is one of those ones Sean's going to sit down, and he's going to be like, I love this, but it should be a video game where it tracks all the things and moves the things for me.
One interesting thing to note, and this goes back to our earlier topic, this one has a number of nominations and awards from Game Awards that I've never heard of. And that's
okay.
That's an interesting one, like the International Games Award and Japan Board Game Prize Voters and like Jug Adult Game of the Year.
I think the thing is, it's not a North American game. Colossal's publishing it over here, and I think that's all it is it's winning awards where it's from, which I don't actually know off the top of my head.
Yeah, because I think Aporta Games is not North American, and Colossal is just bringing it over,
Next up was Skull King. My aunt. My aunt is a big fan of traditional card games. That's why we brought this one. And I've got to say, we now played it at higher player counts. Six players is awesome with this game. Like, you use a lot more to the deck. You can count on certain cards being in play. The biggest problem I find with Skull King with like three players is it's so random. Like, the whole deck's getting shuffled. You never know if there's going to be a mermaid or if there's going to be a pirate, where in this case, you once you're getting up to round 6-7, like, someone's going to have a pirate. Someone might have a mermaid. Definitely there's going to be Trump. And I really liked it with six. And I got to say, that six-player game was the best game of Skull King I've played.
Yeah, it was okay. I like the game. I'm not madly in love with it. It was nice to see how quickly your aunt picked it up. I think it's a great game for family get-togethers like this because it's such an easy game for folks who play traditional trick takers to understand and to enjoy. I mean, even your mom seemed to like it.
Yep.
Yeah, there's just something about these variants of trad card games that just sit well with people who don't identify as gamers.
Now, we still haven't tried the added cards. There are treasure cards, like a treasure chest. There's a whale. There's a kraken. Each of the pirates, I guess, has their own powers. But I got to say, without them, I'd like Skull King. Buy it. Like, it's, if you like trick takers, grab this game. Unless you're like Sean and don't like bidding games, because this is very much a bidding game. Now, one of our trips around Northumberland County, we played a four-player game of the Crooked Crown with the kids. This is the Take That card game, where the only goal is to be the player holding the Crooked Crown card at the end of eight rounds. And card play includes modifying players' hand sizes, peeking at other players' hands, stealing cards, and take that, stuff like that. This was both the kids' first time playing. What I liked about this is Genevieve was reluctant to try, but then really enjoyed it. Both kids loved it. Gwen actually finished the game saying this would be a great one for her friend group. She's going to play it at her birthday party that's coming up, as well as something else she's excited to bring to board game club once high school starts back up.
Yeah, this is really not my style of game, but it is mercifully quick, and the kids were obviously really enjoying it. So, you know, it was fun because they were having fun. And I was looking forward to them trying it because, having played it, I knew they were going to like it. So I was looking forward to that. Mm-hmm. And I liked being right about it. And I had guessed that Gwen would want to bring it and play it at her high school, where I think it's going to be great for that kind of event and for public play events.
Yeah, now I haven't played this one since Origins, but it was a fun, quick game that we sat down and learned with the designer, which was an extra sort of fun twist to how we learned it.
Next was my biggest surprise of the trip. And that was because we went to this small brewery that had a pretty good selection of games, including some hobby games. And one was a fantasy themed two player only board game by Cosmos and Fantasy Flight called Dragonheart. Now, we not only play a lot of games, we play a lot of Cosmos games and Fantasy Flight games. And while, you know, Deanna and I are always on the lookout for two player games, but somehow we missed this game completely. Now, it came out in 2010, so I'm not sure quite how we missed it. Now, it was re-released and re-implemented as Opale in 2019, and while I got to say, I can see why we might have missed it then. This did not seem to have had a North American release, just the original.
I see how I could have missed a game in 2010. That's the year Genevieve was born. I was busy.
There you go. Maybe that was it.
That was one of, if not the single best brewery game shelves I have spotted thus far out in the wild. It was heavy on kids games, but even then it was like the better end of kids games. I remember spotted Sneaky Snacky Squirrel. There was Blockus. There was Ticket to Ride. There must have been a Connect Four because there's always a Connect Four. I don't specifically remember seeing it, but if it wasn't there, I would be shocked.
No, it was good. It was a solid pile. There must have been 20, 40 games. I don't know. It was like multiple shelves.
Yes.
Now, the game itself was kind of neat. It was, I hate saying rock, paper, scissors, because rock, paper, scissors is too simple. But that whole thing where one thing beats another thing that beats another thing that beats the first thing, right? Like you had that little, the trilogy going on there. And each player had an identical deck of cards. And each turn, you're going to play a set of matching cards onto the board. And each type of card was different. They're all fantasy things. So you can play treasure, but if you played treasure, it did nothing. It just sat on the board. But if you played a fire drake, you get to collect everything on the treasure spot. Well, if you played a hunter, you killed the fire drakes and you got to collect the fire drake cards. But then all the hunters went to the spot under the board. Knights could claim sorceress cards, which themselves could capture dragon cards, or the knights could capture ogres. But fallen knights also went under the board. And then all the stuff under the board was captured by playing these boat cards. And once a certain set of boats were played, three boat sets were played, the game ended. Now, there was also a spot where you placed dwarves, and whoever placed the fourth dwarf got to keep all the cards there. And I got to say, even just like reading the instructions and explaining there, it sounds super confusing. But all the board is a bunch of spots to put things with arrows. And honestly, it worked well because the arrow was like this card captures that card. It was solid. And I admit, I kind of wish we had a copy of this one.
Yeah, I'm listening to you describe this and it sounds like this utterly baffling game, and it's actually quite simplistic. You just follow the arrows on the board, this captures that, and there's a decent amount of variability, and then there's definitely that playing chicken aspect of placing cards you hope you'll get to collect in a later round and trying to let the stack get nice and juicy but not have your opponent take it, or trying to play the least worst card because you have to play something and you know he's going to take it. I don't know how it would stand up to multiple plays, but for a one-off it was totally enjoyable. I was ready to play another round, but we were on a timer and had to get going.
Yeah, interestingly, the comments on the lower end are things like, this is a game of setting your opponent up for points, and this does not age well, or if this came out in 2000, it would have been a great and memorable game, but in 2010, no thanks.
Yeah, I got to say, like, 2010 was a long time ago at this point. That's 14 years ago. It felt old. It felt like a classic game. But honestly, I don't know. I think Dan is right. I have a feeling that after multiple plays, we'd be like, yeah, okay. Did dig it, though.
I think it was a remarkably great game to find on the shelf at a brewery, and that's what set it apart.
Yep.
Would I run out and buy a copy of this? Probably not.
That's true. For something we random, like instead of playing Connect Four, we got to play this cool game about knights and dragons. Now, another unique find was a chess-based puzzle game called The Knight's Tour. The information on the box says it was published by RJ Games Co. in Ohio, and we're guessing it sometimes in the 60s. There is no copyright anywhere on the box or board. It's got a wooden board, a single chess knight, and 63 plastic chips. And it's based on the Knight's Tour math puzzle, where you're trying to move a single knight around a chessboard so it lands on every single square without ever duplicating. Now, Deanna, Gwen, and I actually had quite a bit of fun trying to outdo each other while chilling at a cool cafe in Warkworth, Ontario, a very welcoming place with some great food and drinks.
It had this neat horse head piece that, if I had to guess, it's Lucite. Like the type of plastic it is. And that's what made me think it was from the 60s. And just the general look of it, the font, everything. It looked like something I would have pulled out of my grandmother's basement. I don't know. I got the closest and I was still 10 squares off from the solution. It was a fun diversion for the afternoon. But I will say it isn't really a game. It's a logic puzzle that you could play with any chessboard. And we were in this thrift shop and I was looking at a bunch of stuff. Mo held it out to me and said, hey, you think we should buy this? And I was like, it looks old. It looks kind of neat. Sure. And if I had looked more closely at it, I probably would have said, no, we're good.
Does it require you to be able to jump to your starting place at the end on your last move?
That is the ultimate goal. Like once you figured it out, now try to return to your starting place.
That's the the final solution of the Knight's Gambit requires you to be able to not only hit all 64 spots, but then if you move to a 65th time, it would be back to home.
Yeah, that is the ultimate goal. I'll admit we did not figure it out. And honestly, like, except for the fact it's like looks 60s, right? And it's got a nice looking board and fully complete too. Like those look like the original chips. You can play this online for free anywhere. Like just Google.
We have a chessboard. Knight's Path.
Yeah, or if you have a chessboard, but I'm like, you don't have to do that. You can just try forever. I admit I was tempted to play it online once, but I don't know. It was a neat tchotchke. It's one of those things that if we actually had, like, you know, a living room, which if we had a smoking room, you know, or a library, I would leave it out on a table for people to, you know, play and fiddle with while we're talking. Next one was did something a little different, which was kind of fun. Normally, Deanna and I try to play all the games before we introduce them to other people, usually two player. Well, Dee wanted some time to herself to do some reading and work or whatever. And so I sat down with Gwen and the two of us learned New York City from Queen Games. Note New York City, which is part of the Steffenfeld City collection, not just New York, because there's other games called New York and not New York 1901 and so on. Specifically called New York City to set them apart. This is an update to Rialto, which I own. It was from Tasty Minstrel Games. Rest in peace, Tasty Minstrel. Probably was never going to come back otherwise. So far, this is the simplest, quickest game in the City series, the easiest to teach and the most accessible. And it's quite fun. This is an area majority game where you're building skyscrapers in the various boroughs of New York. And you're doing that through a card-driven auction system where there are, I don't even know, 10 auctions each round, 8. I don't know. It's a bunch of auctions. First, you bid on the newspapers and then you bid for money and then you bid for another thing. Now, the big thing that people loved about Rialto, at least the people I listened to and that got me to buy the game, was it was one of the first heavier games to use I split you choose. So one player would get all the cards and would then split them up how they want, but then all the other players got to take their sets of cards first. This removes that completely, gone, not part of the game. So that's a huge change. Now it just pairs of cards are put out and you draft in reverse newspaper order. I gotta say, we enjoyed our first play, but it was rough. It was possibly the roughest game we've ever had with a queen game. The rule book has issues. The setup is incomplete. There is a sentence that says, put out a certain number. It doesn't say what that certain number is. Based on what I found on BoardGameGeek, it seems to be a translation issue from the original German. Every single question we had, and there were multiple, unfortunately, someone on BoardGameGeek posted the answer from the original German rules, translated to English. So that's a bit of a shame, because so far, rule books have not been an issue in the City series at all. Now, once we worked out the kinks, we played a game with Deanna, and it went much smoother, because, well, we had already figured out all the kinks.
Yeah. You guys have worked out all the bugs before I sat down at the table, so I had a smooth, non-extreme experience. I liked it. But not as much as the other City Series games we've played. Like, I would gladly play New York again, but I would pick Hamburg or Marrakesh over it any day. Though it also felt a bit simpler and a bit quicker. So depending on who you're playing with, it might be the better choice.
And maybe I won't run in fear at this one.
I actually fully plan to put this on the menu for tomorrow night at Walkerville Brewery. I think it's going to be a good medium weight game to get people to play things a little bigger. Plus, their tables are big enough to fit in. Now, our last night in Campbellford was spent playing party games. Yeah, I know, strange, right? But this is something I can get my whole family to do. This includes the now traditional play of Telestrations. Ever since introducing my aunt, uncle, and her sister at the time, our first time staying up there, we have to play this. No new memes, no new family jokes came out of this one. No new four-legged ducks, though I did draw a four-legged duck because at one point someone said duck in a boat. So I had, of course, had to draw it with four legs. Listen to previous episodes to get that inside joke. Now, one thing I did this time that I liked, and I had actually, I don't know if this is only in the party pack, but there is a set of competitive scoring rules. And I use them. And I know it's Telestrations, toss out the scoring, but this actually rewards people for chains of correct answers that don't have to match the original clue. So if it like ends up on the wrong track but keeps going down that track, players get points. So I like that. It also rewards someone for bringing it back to the original. So somehow it comes wrapping back around. Amazingly, the person who gets it back on track gets a point. Now, the side effect this had that we found was it stopped people that wrote down answers that don't fit the style of the cards. So our kids had gotten into the habit, if they didn't know what something was, to just write out a sentence describing the last pitcher, which I guess is legal and it fits. But to me, it's kind of against the feel of the game. Now, with this scoring, they knew they couldn't possibly be the right thing. So there was a chance to earn points. So they seemed to make more educated guesses. So I got to say, if you're playing Telestrations, you may not want to toss out that scoring system, because I actually found it improved the game.
Yeah, I don't know. Was it the scoring system that drove that change? Or is it just that they're getting older and are more likely to make semi-logical guesses versus writing down something wild like a four-legged duck in a boat with something chasing it, you know? Because I found even the first round before the scoring was introduced, they were, I think, doing better guesses. I didn't mind the scoring. I thought it was okay. It's probably a little more enjoyable than the original.
Plus, it's less subjective. The original scoring is, what was the best pitcher? Okay, who was the best guess?
Points for Gwen. Points for, exactly.
Right? Like, I didn't enjoy as much. So we wrapped up a full game of Telestrations, three rounds. Then I brought out something new for everyone, and that was Caution Signs. I didn't know what to expect from my aunt and uncle, but they loved it, which is great. I not that I don't like Telestrations, but I like having another option to play with the entire family. Both of them, especially my uncle, actually noted that their favorite part of the game was watching another player talk through their deductive reasoning. Like, oh, I think that's a this. No, he looks kind of stinky. Wait, if that's stinky, oh, no, that one's got to be jumping. You know, that part of the game, they greatly enjoyed. They also commented on how well designed the clues were. So sometimes it was just blatantly obvious. Yeah, that's a cowboy. Yeah, that's that. That there tends to be that one clue every time that could be one of two things, right? Like, is that a leopard or is that a tiger? Which one is it? Plus, everyone agreed the 20-second time limit kind of makes the game work because of the drawing skills, especially like Gwen at the table, besides being a better drawer than any of us, has gotten good at drawing quick now. So it used to be that like Telestrations, because of the time limit, she still had to, no, now she draws fully detailed pictures when we play Telestrations. Well, even she did not really have enough time in this particular game due to the time limit.
Yeah, we should have placed a bet beforehand because I was certain that your aunt and uncle would enjoy this game. Caution Signs has yet to fail. Yep. This game is fun with everyone. I think being the guesser is the most fun part of the game. But yeah, sitting there while someone else is guessing, if they're talking out loud and explaining their choices, that can be a hoot.
Now, I do want to point out some insider. There may be an expansion coming. Caution Signs is being played by the designer at a fantasy con, and she has spent the last couple days coming up with fantasy clues. Now, I don't know if that's going to be a con exclusive or if Danielle was kind of hinting at something to come. But I got to say, I was kind of hyped.
War in the Empire. Karl Franz is dead. Who will replace him as emperor? Decide the fate of the old world in Warhammer Fantasy Roleplay Elector Counts, an old world game.
Old world card game. Despite being right in the title, this card game has nothing to do with Warhammer Fantasy Roleplay, the role-playing game, except for the setting and theme. Now you can thank Cubicle 7 for that one, and we've got to thank them for hooking us up with a review copy of this Warhammer-themed game.
This 2-4-player single-deck card game comes from the well-known designer Martin Wallace. It's a re-implementation of Martin's earlier game, Doctor Who the Card Game. This new version features the classic Warhammer fantasy theme originally created by Games Workshop and set before all that silly Age of Sigmar stuff.
Games of Elector Counts are pretty quick once you get past your first play or two, usually lasting under half an hour. The mechanics are rather straightforward, and most of the weight of the game actually comes from learning the deck and remembering what has or has not been played. While Cubicle 7 has an age listed of 13+, the community comes in closer at 8+.
And seeing as I got into Warhammer Fantasy back when I was about 8, that sounds about right to me for a Warhammer game. Now, in Elector Counts, each player has their own province represented by a card in front of them. Each turn, players will play cards adding new holdings to their lands, adding defenders to their existing holdings, or sending out raiders to attack other players' holdings. Combat is deterministic, with the highest card total controlling the location. The fun part comes in when you're down to only three cards, which you must then pass to your player on your right.
This card-based Warhammer game comes in a small box, which contains cardboard tokens for each player, some cardboard coins, and over 100 cards. As a nice bonus, you get some spares for each of the tokens. The cards are sturdy, they feature awesome Warhammer art, clear iconography, and unambiguous card text. The rulebook is a bit wordy, but it's good.
At the start of the game of an Elector counts, each player gets a starting province and a starting hand of cards, with the player to the right of the dealer getting three less cards than everyone else.
Each turn, players will take as many actions as they want, but they have to finish their turn when they're down to only three cards, and those three cards are passed to the player on their right. They then refill their hand with cards from the deck.
Location cards are played in front of you. They may grant coins and will award victory points to the player who controls each of them at the end of the game.
Coins can be spent to purchase more cards and can be gained from some support, attacker, and defender cards, as well as locations.
Now, attackers are played in front of an opponent's location card along with a siege token. They must be played in sets of the same card or in a set of matching allies. Each card has a number on it, and you're going to add these up when resolving a battle.
Defenders are played at your own locations, and unlike attackers, each defender must have a unique name. The defender cards are numbered, similar to attackers.
When there are attackers and defenders at the same location, all cards are flipped. Card abilities go off, and the total numbers on each side are added up. Attackers must discard cards equal to the value of the defenders. If any attackers remain, they control the location. If the defenders have a higher total of all cards are all cards are then discarded, and the defender gets to place a fortification token on that location. The next attack card played at that location is automatically defeated, and the token is then discarded.
Support cards do all kinds of funky things. Modify attack and defense totals, let you peek at face-down cards, move cards around on the table, earn you coins, draw more cards, and so on. Now, players also have the option to put cards in their reserve. Each player can hold two cards over from turn to turn, and they can access the cards and play from the reserve at any time.
If at any point a single player has five siege tokens in play, or they have five fortification tokens out, or they have a combination of both siege and fortification tokens that total up to eight or more, then the game immediately ends. Assuming that doesn't happen, the game continues with players playing, then passing cards until the end of game card comes up, which gets seeded into the deck, placed 20 cards from the bottom of the deck.
Players add up victory points for each location they control, and the player with the most points wins.
Now, what this overview doesn't really address is the fact that pretty much every single card in Elector counts does something else. It's not just a defense card. It's not just an attack card. Some attackers generate coins when you play them. Some defenders return to your hand when defeated. There are support cards that have a permanent effect if in your reserve. And there's a series of cards that feature kind of a rock, paper, scissor-like mechanic where this card automatically defeats this other card, but it's itself defeated by a third card and things like that.
The other thing that isn't obvious from this overview is how much Warhammer fantasy lore there is in this game. And a lot of the mechanics are tied to the lore. For example, it's the flagellants that return to your hand ready to defend again and again after being beaten. And lumping crooks fighting cooks make an appearance as an ally card that can be played with any attacker. And they generate coins, which let you attract more troops. There are many amusing nods to Warhammer fantasy that fans of the setting will enjoy.
Now, I think we need to start off by sharing that our first play of this game wasn't great. Now, that play was at a game convention after a long day of meetings, demos, and exploring the con with lots and lots of walking. That had an impact. But the learning game here was rough. Like, why did we agree to review this rough?
Yeah, and now having played more times, I do think con fatigue was part of it. But another part is that this game is opaque. It has a steep learning curve. Without knowing what to expect from the deck the first time playing, you're just floundering. You don't know what you should do, what you shouldn't do, why you should keep cards, why you should do things. And I got to say, the cards themselves don't really lend themselves in any way to pointing to a strategy. Like, do I defend my stuff? Do I attack the opponents? Do I build up strategy cards? What do I pass to my opponent? What's a good card? What's a bad card? And many of the cards reference other cards. And until you've seen both played, you have no clue what that card does.
Yeah, this is a game that rewards repeat plays. It is a game that almost requires mastery just to enjoy it.
And theme buy-in helps as well. If you don't know or care about Warhammer lore, it's hard to engage fully in this game.
Now, thankfully, this was a hurdle, right? It was a hurdle to overcome. And once you overcome that hurdle, I found a really solid game here. Even by my second play, I was starting to see like the design work that went into it and the way the tug of war kind of happens at each locations. And I found the game had a very multiplayer version of Schottentotten or Battle Line. Kind of felt like playing that with multiple people, and I was enjoying it more. But I got to say, it was probably not until my fourth play that I started to like enjoy the game and have fun playing it. And all of that fun came from actually knowing the deck and getting some rules mastery and knowing what worked and knowing how to balance attacking and defending and realizing that just trying to get five attack tokens out is pretty much impossible and so on.
I think everyone at the table needs to know the game and have played it multiple times for it to be an enjoyable experience. Yeah. Once we had played it multiple times, it was fine. Like sitting down and introducing it to someone new, it would be less enjoyable.
Yeah, and I can just confirm that. That first play was rough. And as a result of that first play, my lack of eagerness to play it again was really there. Now, thankfully, I did play it again, and that game absolutely does benefit from those multiple plays. I am not going to turn down the chance to play this game again, having played it twice. But having only played it once, there was some struggle to get me to play it the second time.
Same, yeah. Sean. Mo brought it out to a coffee shop, and we were supposed to be on a date night, and I was like, why? Why do this to me?
Now, once you do kind of get the game, you start to grok it, right? You start to understand what's going on. The most interesting thing I found was the fact it's drafting, right? You are giving cards to your opponents. Like, you have no choice. At two or three players, you know half of the options one of your opponents has. At two player, you're directly handing your opponent those three cards, and you know half their hand. And that is a big part of the game. Deciding what to play, what to pass, and what to reserve is actually a fun decision tree once you understand the value of those cards. It's one of those drafting games like Seven Wonders, where there's those cards that just aren't that useful, and you see them get passed around in circles again and again and again. Though, interestingly, you can sell cards as well to get some money. So sometimes when they come around so much, it's just a card to toss out. But then if you're tossing out that garbage card, then you got to pass them something good, right? That's the part of the game that I like. It's also what makes those rock, paper, scissor matchups work. Because at first I'm like, well, yeah, the Glaren Theogenist instantly kills the sorceress. But how do I know they have the sorceress? Well, I know if I just passed it to them. Then I hold on to the Grand Theogenist in my reserve, and then they got to say, well, they passed me the Sorceress. Do they have the Grand Theogenist? And I got to say, that's actually a lot of fun. Plus, even if you do memorize everything, right, the whole Grand Theogenist Sorceress thing, well, there's 20 cards that aren't in play every game. Technically, a couple of those could get drawn if someone has additional turns at the end of the game or ways to draw cards. But in general, you're removing a bunch of cards from the deck at the start of the game by putting that end game card 20 deep.
Yeah, but what you have to do is you have to sell the good cards and pass them the garbage. That's how you do it.
There you go.
The one part I don't like is those named characters where they have the very specific rock, paper, scissor abilities based on who else is in play. I get that part of this is game's mastery and knowing who counters who, but like it's a big deck. And having that exact combination come up feels extremely unlikely. It's actually never come up in any of our many games. And I just kind of find it annoying. And when I get those cards, I tend to not hold on to them.
Yeah. And
hint. I just gave a hint on what I do.
It's notable that the game plays very differently at all three player counts with of 2 to 4 players, with most people agreeing that 2 players is where it is strongest. And I suspect that's in large part because you're not worrying about who else you ought to be attacking. It's just you and your opponent. At four players, the game seems to really kind of grind and slow down. So it's just not ideal unless you're all experienced fans of the game.
Yeah, and the thing I've called out too, the other thing with the two-player game is you know you're passing those cards to the opponent, and you're going to be able to remember that better. You're passing the same cards back and forth. You're not giving to a player on your right who might attack you or might attack that person or might do something else. I think that adds to a very take that confrontational feel.
And I will say I was hesitant to play this game two players at first, again, because that first play was so rough and it was only the second time we were getting it to the table. But also because it said variant rules, and variant rules for two players kind of turns me off. But it was a really tiny variant. There was just like a handful of cards that you remove because they're not going to play well with two players. And then you play as normal pretty much. So it is an incredibly strong game at two players. And overall, at any player count, I like the drafting mechanic. I like that way that you're passing the attack cards to your opponent while trying to make sure that you have the good stuff to count. You know, like that knowledge of what's going around the table, it's interesting.
Now, while getting a set number of tokens, right, that 5 siege token, 5 fortifications, or 8 total is a win condition. I think once you get experienced players playing the game, you're going to go to that end of game card most often. And other reviewers seem to confirm this as well. And I got to say, once you get there, I love the finish in this game, because once the card comes up, you only get to play one action a turn. And there's this whole game of chicken that starts as players try to eke out just one more action. And especially if you've saved up some location cards to drop down because you want to throw them down uncontested, but you're waiting because you're like, oh, do they have any attack cards left? Because if I drop them and I don't have the fence, I'm just giving my opponents points. I really digged that end game. And I got to say, it felt kind of Warhammer to me. That end game, just that last round where everyone's playing single cards, kind of had a Warring States Elector account thing going on. And I really enjoyed it.
Yes, I love that part. I love that end game where you are trying to eke it out for as long as possible and draw it out so that you don't have any turns left and now I can still do things. I will be able to attack you. You will not be able to defend, you know, all of that. I'm not as crazy about the instant immediate ending when someone gets enough tokens in play, but it's a thing.
Yeah, there's that whole level of playing chicken in this game that really sort of catches some people's attentions.
Now, of course, this learning curve and having to get to know a 100 plus card deck is going to be the biggest turnoff for some prospective players. For us, I think the only reason we kept trying so hard was the Warhammer theme. Like, we are all Warhammer fans. We fought to find the joy. And I can see non-Warhammer fans not finding the game worth the effort.
Yeah, I think people who are unfamiliar with the theme will find far less to hook them here.
To be fair, I probably would have had more interest and might not even have had as negative a first game experience in the Doctor Who version, as it's more fresh in my mind than Warhammer. While I adore Warhammer's grimdark setting, it has been a long time since I've taken part in it. So it's harder to get excited about some of those aspects that are so, you know, far in the past.
Now, another thing to watch for is interplayer conflict. There's tons, right? This is a card-driven war game. You will be attacking the other players. This is not a game where you can turtle. And there are a lot of take-that cards where even you have the best attackers ever, this huge army, and they only have one defense card, but then they drop that support card from their hand or reveal the card in the reveal. It's almost got a munchkin level of take-that. This is not a game to play with your friends who usually stick to cooperative and friendly games. Just like the lore the game is based on, things can get pretty nasty. This isn't heroic fantasy. This is a Warhammer game, after all.
This is a war. You are not friends. There is no cooperation, though there is social deduction and bluffing when committing troops to locations.
All is as it should be.
So overall, our experience with Warhammer Fantasy Roleplay Elector Counts, an old world card game, has been a bit of a journey. We had a bad first experience, and for a bit there, it felt like we were chasing the fun. Once we all had a few games under our belt, though, we discovered a solid game. But it's not a game that will be for everyone in any way. We always say not every game is for everyone. Well, this isn't going to appeal to a large audience. There are going to be people, though, who will dig it. Now, in addition to the learning curve, this is a rather nasty game of direct conflict. Not everyone is going to enjoy that.
Yeah, sadly for this game, not many people are willing to put in the effort to learn to like a game. And that's going to limit the audience who's talking positively about this game.
And this is not a one and done game. This is a game to play and learn and master. And then you can enjoy playing it over and over again with other folks who are on the same wavelength as you.
Of course, the main crowd who should be looking at this game are the longtime Warhammer fans like us. You're going to love seeing famous Warhammer characters from, honestly, all of the game's iterations over the years. Going all the way back to the original Regiments of Renown, which gave me some joy. Just don't pick this up if you're looking for Warhammer Fantasy Roleplay content. Like, I know it's on the box, but there is nothing here. The closest it gets is Cubicle 7 claims this is a game that that is popular in taverns and pubs across the old world. So I guess if you want to have your players do some gambling, you could play a game of this, but I think you're better off just making some stat rolls.
That seems a little meta. If you enjoy games like Battleline, Air, Land, and Sea, the classic Atlantean, or maybe even Lost Cities, you may really enjoy Elector Counts. The combat system here of attackers played at a location being paired off against defenders at that same location feels very much like those games to me.
The main takeaway, if you are interested in this game at all, is not to give up after that first play. You will start off lost and some card abilities won't make any sense and you won't know what you should do. That will come with time and a couple more plays.
Now, one final note, we brought it up a couple times, but this is based on the Doctor Who card game. Well, that game actually won the 2013 Best Traditional Card Game Award at Origins, the Gold. So I got to say, the game has some solid pedigree there. There were definitely things fans liked. Now, I haven't personally tried the Doctor Who version, but I think it may be worth checking out. I did notice that the Board Game Geek ratings are identical. So it seems like people like them equally. So if you are a Whovian, maybe check that out.
Now, to clarify, that's new Whovians. The game features modern Doctors 9 through 12 and their companions. So don't go pinning celery on your jacket and sitting down to it. Now, if you've listened to this and have played the Doctor Who game, we would love to hear how they compare, especially if you've played both games. While we do love our Warhammer, we do enjoy some timey-wimey shenanigans from time to time as well. It's 1944, and the world is at war. In a bedroom in Brooklyn, a boy is taken to the dark by the boogeyman, and it's up to you, as some of his toys, to save him. In the dark, toys come to life and will confront bitter and forgotten toys, and may end up questioning their own loyalty to the boy.
That's what the Stuff of Legend story is all about. First presented in comic book form and now brought into the world of board games by Third World Studio, or 3WS, who we have to thank for hooking us up with a review copy of this Hidden Traitor cooperative board game. Now, the board game plays through the first comic book in the series, The Dark.
And before we get too far into it, we want to mention the tone and theme of this game. This is not Stuff Fables. The Stuff of Legend comic and the board game are dark and twisted. You are not cute little toys trying to save an innocent child. If the thought of playing a game where you could potentially betray a child and there is a child in danger, if that is not for you, we fully understand you skipping over this review and avoiding the game entirely. And in case it's not clear, this is not a kid's game in any way. But on the other hand, it's also not adult in any way. It's not sexy or disturbingly violent. Our teenagers enjoyed playing it, and they're pretty squeamish. It's just not for little kids, both in subject matter and difficulty level.
Now, The Stuff of Legend was designed by Kevin Wilson and features artwork from Charles Paul Wilson III. It plays 3 to 6 players, but it plays best with at least 4 and having 5 as the sweet spot. Games can take quite a while, lasting up to 2 hours as long as the players are playing smartly and know the game. A quicker defeat can be expected during learning games.
Mm-hmm. Now, the component quality in this semi-cooperative game is notable, and I suggest you check out our The Stuff of Legend unboxing video on YouTube to get a good look at what you get. There you'll see the awesome oversized miniatures for the boy and the boogeyman and the player piece. You'll get to see the various forgotten toy miniatures, standees for the characters, tokens, and more. Now, what we have is the standard edition of the game. There is also a deluxe Kickstarter version, which has minis for all the player characters and some other upgrades.
Our only complaint about this game component-wise is that the box insert, it's pretty much only good for protecting those big minis. Other than that, there's just some wells that you end up tossing everything into. There is no organization provided, and you will have cards sliding around everywhere. You need to at least add some baggies. And while we haven't done it yet, we've been very tempted to just toss the entire insert and baggie everything, including the minis.
Now, start a game of the Stuff of Legend by seeding the board with cards and adversaries. Each spot on the board gets one or more encounter cards covered by a location card. Forgotten toys are placed where indicated, and then you randomize the 7 exit tokens and place 4 of them out on the board. The goal of the game is for the group to escape through the highest numbered portal present. The twist being, if both the 7 and the 1 are present, the 1 is what's counted as highest.
Next, each player chooses a character. The game includes a set of basic and advanced characters, and we recommend starting with the basic ones. Each character provides 2 skill icons, has a positive special ability, and a negative consequence that goes off whenever they use a stained card. Everyone gets a starting hand of cards.
The final thing you do before starting to play the Stuff of Legend is to determine each toy's loyalty. A loyalty deck is built, and the cards are dealt out randomly, including one hidden card that's placed on the boy. 2 of these loyalty cards assign special roles to players, roles that mean they start off as publicly loyal to the boy and also get special abilities, though these cards can later end up being passed to other players. And if you're playing with less than 6, one of the special roles is removed. The other loyalty cards either indicate that the player is loyal to the boy or loyal to the boogeyman.
So you know the loyalty of at least 1 player with 2 to 6 players at the start of the game, and you know exactly how many loyal to the boogeyman cards there are in play. When playing with 3 or 4 players, it's highly possible that everyone starts loyal. Once you get up to 5 or 6, you know at least 1 player starts off as a traitor.
Now, another aspect of the game worth mentioning before we get into actual play mechanics is that many actions in the game require your group to take a vote. Votes are also called whenever there's a group decision to be made and the group can't reach consensus.
Rounds in the Stuff of Legend alternate. Players take 3 actions, 1 each for 3 different characters, and then you have a boogeyman phase where events happen and the forgotten toys on the board act, and then you go back to player actions and so on.
On the player side of things, everyone decides who will act, which could lead to a vote. Once the character has acted, they can't act again until all other characters have taken an action, and the game has a cool toy box mechanic for tracking this.
When taking an action, you can do a basic action. You can play an action card from your hand or pass by discarding a card. Basic actions include moving to new spots on the board, which could lead to a vote, or hiding, which reduces the attention level track.
The attention level track represents how much attention the boogeyman is paying to your group of heroic toys. It determines how far away the forgotten toys can see you from and how powerful they are. There are a number of things that can affect this track, including action cards, moving down quiet or noisy paths, or hiding.
When you move onto a new spot on the board, you flip over all of the adjacent location cards and activate any special text on them. You then flip over the encounter cards at the location you move to and resolve them.
Now, instead of moving or hiding, you can play an action card from your hand. There are all kinds of these. They include things like the ability to scout ahead and peek at encounter cards, escaping from danger if you're surrounded by minions, battling the forgotten toys, challenging leaders that are up on the board, peeking at the exits, swapping loyalty cards, and a lot more.
Many actions and some encounter cards require your group to pass a test. There are 3 types of tests, and each has a target number. It is up to the acting player to provide enough skill icons to meet or beat this number to pass. Each character starts with 2 icons, and in addition, every card in the game can be used for skill icons. If a player can't meet the target on their own, other players can offer to help by contributing cards.
The problem is that some cards are stained, painted by the boogeyman. If a player plays or accepts help in the form of a stained card, their character's weakness is activated, and these are all rather nasty.
Now, if a player ever runs out of cards, they must draw a new hand, but first, they flip the boogeyman coin. One side shows the boy. If that comes up, the boy token moves down the boy is lost track. If it hits the last space, the players loyal to the boy lose. All other players win. The other side of the coin shows the boogeyman. If you flip that up, you now reveal and enact a card from the boogeyman deck, a stack of cards that do nasty things and in general make everything harder, either for the player who drew it or for the whole group.
Players also have the option to ditch their hand early at any point, but this requires a vote, and then the coin is flipped as normal.
Once the three players have taken one action, it's time for bad stuff to happen. First, all cards on the board with boogeyman symbols on them activate. Then, any troops or leaders at the location with the party do damage. Then, troops within attention range move towards the player's group.
Now, damage taken is tracked on a damage track on the board, and it starts off with players having to discard cards. That escalates, eventually swapping to flipping the boogeyman coin with the same effects we just described. If you reach the end of the track, you actually restart from the beginning, starting to discard cards and then flipping again. Now, each time damage is taken, it's up to the group to decide who is going to take the penalty, which of course could lead to a vote.
Play continues until either the boy mini hits the end of the boy's lost track or the group moves onto a portal space. When this happens, you reveal all of the portals on the board. And if the one they have moved on to is the highest number portal, everyone loyal to the boy wins, and anyone loyal to the boogeyman loses.
I think that pretty much covers things, at least in a broad overview. There's quite a bit more going on through the various event cards, exploring the map, finding allies, getting to peek at exit tokens, changing loyalties, and more. But we hope this was enough to give you a good idea of how the stuff of Legend plays.
Now, personally, I can't help but compare this game to my favorite Hidden Traitor game of all time, and honestly, one of my favorite board games of all time, and that is Battlestar Galactica from Fantasy Flight Games. The way the traitor mechanics work here and how you can swap allegiances partway through the game really reminds me of Battlestar Galactica in a good way. Now, the best part of Stuff of Legend, though, is that it's not fragile like Battlestar Galactica is, at least not in the plays we've played. You don't tend to get the problem of a player taking the role of their character from the show more seriously than they should. At least I've seen that happen multiple times in BSG and actually ruin the game. Same with the card play is just a little simpler, and you don't tend to have people making mistakes in the game that ruin it for everyone. Plus, it's also not the 3 to 6 hour experience that when it does get ruined, you've wasted a lot more time. Now, I have to say this could be a problem, this whole especially playing a role, if players have read the comic, but none of us have, so I don't know if that's possible. Like, if you know, Quackers in the comic ends up being a traitor, if someone playing Quackers would play like a traitor.
I like that there are some known factors at the table. Having one or two people that you know are loyal to the boy makes for an interesting dynamic, and of course, things change.
Yeah, I expect this is probably all more related to those who know the content. If you haven't watched Battlestar Galactica, you're not going to know the shifting alliances of the show and be tempted to play the traitor wrongly. Had we read the graphic novels, this might have been an issue here as well, as knowledge can color your actions, even unintentionally sometimes.
Yep. Now, the Stuff of Legend has everything I want in a cooperative hidden role game. It has an RPG aspect. I'm playing a character. I'm playing a toy. I'm Quackers or whatever. And that gives me that step back, right? That once removed level of me, Mo, lying to my friends and being a traitor. Like, to me, that's when it's acceptable, right? You're playing a role. I like the card mechanics. You can hide your role well, especially with the stained cards. It's very easy to claim, oh, sorry, I can help you out, but all I have stained cards. When you may not, but you can then discard those cards to hide later and no one will catch the deception. I love the fact, like Deanna said, that you're going to know some of the loyalties in the game. They're set. You're well aware. Plus, there's the whole fact that there are cards that let you peek at loyalty cards, but then convincing the rest of the group is part of the game. I think that's a great touch. And I also like that it is highly possible there may be no traitor for the entire game, but that only happens if you're playing with 4 or less. If you are playing with 5 or more, you're guaranteed there will be a traitor. But even then, it's never going to be half the group. It's always a small number of players.
Now, I'll admit I'm not a fan of hidden traitor games, and that includes these like BSG, where there's some role playing involved. This is not a game I would purchase or play with my family. But that being said, I completely see the interest people have in them, and I will admit that this is a well-crafted form of that mechanic that does some really interesting things with the changing traitor and changing allegiances.
Yeah, I totally agree. I struggled with how to word this. Like, I give this game a good review. It's a good game. It is not a game for me. It is not a style of game that I enjoy, and I am not going to seek it out to play, and I would even go to the point of trying to avoid being at the table to play it. But I can look at it and acknowledge that they're doing a good job of it here. This is a great hidden trader game. It does the mechanic well. It does some things unique. It is a really solid game, and it's just not a game for me.
Now, me, on the other hand, I like certain hidden trader games, and this is one of them. Shadows over Camelot, one of my favorite. BSG was my favorite game of all time until I saw it break down a couple times in a row. This is up there. Now, the problem I found, especially during the early plays of the game, that it's just a hard cooperative game, like a dang hard cooperative game. There is a definite advantage if you are loyal to the boogeyman to just play along. And the group's probably going to lose anyway. You might not have to do much. Like, this is not a plotting, I'm going to betray you at every corner kind of game. This is more of a one or two sidle plays might be enough to shift it. Though we did find this changed after more plays, once people got to know the cards, and, well, more importantly, once people realize they want to be the traitor, because that's the other thing in this game. Is the easiest way to win is actually to be the traitor because the game's hard. So I know everyone wants to be the hero, but when you start realizing the actual metagame here is be on the right side by the end of the game, things get a lot more interesting. People will actually try to become the traitor. And I actually really like that. I think that's an interesting twist to the game.
So yes, while it is hard, I wouldn't say it's quite punishingly hard.
No.
But it is certainly at that level where you're not going to win the majority of times. It's a real challenge that requires effort and a bit of luck, like most modern cooperative games these days. You know?
Yep.
In a way, it reminded me of when we first played Shadows over Camelot, where victory felt almost impossible. Yeah. And I think I actually like that aspect a bit. I hate when cooperative games feel like a walk in the park.
And similar to Shadows over Camelot, at this point, we played so many games of Shadows over Camelot, I find it too easy without hidden traitors. Like if you just play cooperatively, well, I'd end up being an alpha gamer and quarterbacking and we'll win because I played the game enough times. And I find this is similar. The more we played, definitely the easier it was getting. What I actually recommend and something I kind of wish we'd done is anyone who's picking up this game new, play with a group for the first time, just play with everyone loyal. Make it open. Don't even hand out loyalty cards, because this will give you a chance to explore the game, understand how things work without having to worry about traitors in your midst. And I would even suggest doing this multiple times, like play this way until you win, and only add in the loyal to the boogeyman cards once you've beaten the game at least once. Because as a fully cooperative game, this game's solid. Like, I tend to play it as if everyone's good until they've done something really obvious to point out their traitor, and it's a lot of fun. I think there's more than enough challenge in the stuff of Legend to keep a group entertained just as a cooperative game. Now, what's interesting about that is that means this game might appeal to cooperative game players. Just be aware, if you buy it, you're not playing by the rules as written.
So personally, I feel like the game might wear a little thin without the traitor mechanic. It's a great learning method, but I'm not sure it's sustainable as a rule, in large part because it makes a number of cards and events in the game moot.
Now, one thing I did not expect from the stuff of Legend, and something I'm actually disappointed in, this is my biggest disappointment with this game, is a lack of story. Now, perhaps if I'd read the comics, I wouldn't mind, because the location cards would make sense to me and the characters would. But as it stands, the location cards are just names. And then they have mechanics on the back that say, like, discard this card and add true troops. Not why. There's no flavor text on any of the cards. There's no background. Even the characters don't have much of a story of who they are. I don't know who any of the leaders that pop up while you were playing. I just, when looking at the game, when doing, like, getting a short overview, when we saw it at a con, I was expecting more of a thematic story game. Some type of exploration. Some, maybe even like a talisman feel of wandering around a map and discovering things. When playing, it's very mechanical and honestly kind of methodical. Well, you do get those feelings of being lost. You get the exploration. You feel challenged by the and it's adversarial. And you get the tracks are almost running out. You get that cooperative game panic. But I never really got the feeling that we're playing toys that had come to life. And I just kind of felt like this theme could have worked with any other team rescuing someone, and the game would still work.
Yeah, and the setting is so evocative. Like, I definitely, when we were first sitting down to play it, and you read it, and we saw the cards and the art and the way the board looked, I was expecting more story elements in the game, and then they just never surfaced, and I was kind of really surprised by it that first game.
Now, 3WS Games is also the publisher of the comic book and of the graphic novels, so there's obviously, you know, expected tie-in. I haven't played BSG, but if I had never seen the show, would anything about playing BSG give me the story of Battlestar Galactica? Like, is it identifiable to people who haven't watched the show?
I think so. I there's flavor text on every card that talks about, oh, the engine room is on fire, what do you do to stop it, instead of just saying engine room. And the characters have backgrounds that you can read off. And there are key moments in the show that recreate key moments from the series, like stopping on, I can't remember, it's been too long since I've watched Battlestar Galactica, but you stop on the one planet halfway through the game, and then you leave again. And every time you jump, the captain gets to pick between which sectors to jump from. And, like, to me, that was all very thematic. And there's things to read off. There are Cylon events that, again, are all based on events that happened in the show. But even if you didn't know the show, you definitely get the spaceship running away from aliens who just keep showing up and running low on resources. I don't know. To me, it seemed very thematic. And the re-themes were only ever done on the Express version. I don't think. Now, to be fair, there's Unfathomable. Well, BSG has been fully rethemed by the people who developed it, but I haven't played that, so I can't really tell you how it compares. Now, another thing to note for people who do know the story, this is The Dark. It's book one of a multi-part comic book series. You don't get the whole story. And honestly, in the end, you don't rescue the boy. So one of the people I played with when I hosted a public play event at a local place that played this didn't like the fact they're like, well, we went through the portal, now what? And I'm like, yeah, it doesn't really tell you. I don't know what happens. So honestly, when I teach the game, I'm just like, you get through the portal, you save the boy. Yay. How do we save the boy? I don't know. I haven't read the comics.
Yeah, I'm sure to those who are familiar with the story, it's possibly a poignant and even emotional moment, but we haven't.
Now, my other complaint is that box insert. Well, I haven't done it yet. I think next time I play, I'm just going to toss it and put everything in the bags. I haven't painted any of the minis, and the little ones are already loose. So I don't and they're that board game plastic, right? I don't think they're going to break.
Yeah, this is one that should be in our list of bad inserts. It looks like it's going to be wonderful. Oh, look at this fancy insert. It does nothing.
So overall, I enjoy Stuff of Legends. While it wasn't quite what I expected, I was hoping for kind of an adventure story game where I'd be like, oh, when we played last time, we went into the forest, and then from the forest, we went away. You don't really get any of that. I don't usually have a story to tell after the game, though I will say the last time we played, we jumped into a damn 6, and the only thing that could have come up was a 7 to ruin it, and it was a 7. And I got to say, that was a great feeling, like we were this close to winning. You get that, but you just don't get that story of toys journeying, and the only reason I know I'm beating up other toys and not cowboys is because the rule book told me so. But I will say, this is the best hidden trader game I played since Battlestar Galactica. If I had to choose between the two, I gotta say BSG still wins out for me, but only with an experienced group that knows the game and won't mess it up. Now, if I have even one new player, or I'm introducing this to new players, I'm gonna be grabbing the Stuff of Legends for that hidden trader itch.
Now, this game isn't for me, but it's an interesting game to experience. The twice I've played this now, I would not ask to play it, but I probably wouldn't fight too hard if that's what the group wanted to play.
Yeah, I'm with Sean on this one. This game is not for me. I think it's well done and it's fun for what it is. It's just not the style of game that I enjoy.
Now, for those of you who do enjoy semi-cooperative board games with hidden traders and don't mind dark themes, check it out. Stuff 11's good. This is one of the best games I played in the genre.
If you like cooperative games, even if you don't like those with hidden trader mechanics, I encourage you to try out the Stuff of Legend if you can. There's something about the way the trader mechanics work here, with knowing certain people are loyal and only a low number of potential traders in the game, where we've found that people who don't normally like that kind of thing end up enjoying this. Plus, there's also always the option to house rule it and drop the traders entirely.
Now, while I haven't read the Stuff of Legend comics, my guess would be that fans will probably love this game. For you, you're going to know who the leaders are. You're going to recognize the locations from the comments and the comics, and the events are going to be familiar. I honestly think that would bring this game to another level.
And that's all we have to say about the stuff of Legend. While none of us are big fans of Hidden Trader games, some games do it right and they become the exception to the rule. And the stuff of Legend was one of those games.
What is your favorite semi-cooperative, team-based, or Hidden Trader game? We want to know. Post a comment wherever you found this review, or better yet, start up a conversation at the Tabletop Bellhop Discord at discord.tabletopbellhop.com. That was the double bell.
That means the shift's done. It's time to go home. We're going to do some sweeping in here. We got a couple packages that showed up that we're going to open, but we're going to have to lock the lobby doors.
And before we start tidying things up, let's take a moment to thank a selection of our Tabletop Bellhop Patreon patrons.
Brian Van Beek, thank you, Brian.
William Fisher, thank you.
Andrew Dacey, thank you, Andrew.
Danielle and Owen Thomas, thank you. Good to see you in the chat tonight.
Sean P. Kelly, thanks, Sean.
Derek Hissen, thanks, Derek.
Your first stop to finding us should be at tabletopbellhop.com, but you can find us all over the web as Tabletop Bellhop, one word, and on your podcatcher of choice as the Tabletop Bellhop Gaming Podcast. Now, Pocket Casts just added the ability to review podcasts in the app, so it would be awesome if those of you who use it, and I know there are some of you out there, left us a review.
And we're not just a podcast. You can get even more Bellhop by joining our Patreon. Get access to our weekly show notes, bonus audio like the outtake we just created, first thoughts reviews, and more.
That's all for us for tonight.
For the Tabletop Bellhop Gaming Podcast, I'm Sean.
I'm Deanna.
And I'm Mo.
Thank you.
And
game on.